إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد brothers fear Allah سبحانه وتعالى have the taqwa, the righteousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala into your characters, in all of your sayings and actions, whatever you do, whatever you behave and say in this life, the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being God-fearing in this life, is the true key for the Muslim salvation in this life and in the next lives. Any nation without any predecessors, they can live and follow according to them. They have no history in this life. We, the Ummah of Islam, the nation of Islam, the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, its goodness and barakah, it was made and placed in the early generations among the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions and the followers of the companions, etc. We, the Ummah of Islam, we have the glory and the civilizations that we should be proud of has never been matched by any other nation or civilizations in the history of mankind. Because its predecessors and its minhaj is the prophetic minhaj, the way of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The best prophecy ever known in the history of mankind. And every generation of this Ummah used to live on the footprints of their early leaders and imams to follow and to learn from. In fact, they used to raise up their children on the biography and the life story of our pious and righteous predecessors, generation after generation, from which they can get goodness and happiness and knowing how to live this life until they die. In our times, however, unfortunately, the whims the keenness of the youth of the Muslims, many of them had fallen short to follow the same way of their previous predecessors. Instead of taking and following the footprints of those pious and righteous peoples, in our times, many of our youngsters, unfortunately, are still taking and seeking examples from other nations. Among the singers, actors, actresses, and those who so-called them today as the stars to follow for peoples. And many of those people are non-Muslims, unfortunately. So they live this life, these youngsters, Muslims, they know very little or even none of the history of their best examples among the previous predecessors. From this point, it's important that we touch upon the biography of one of the great men of this ummah, that you will never find the same examples in the history of Islam, except very little of it. We should know his biography. We should teach our children, our families, the biography of this great God-fearing man who lived for a short time in this life as one of the great caliphs of Islam. He is, as the ulama say, the fifth rightly guided caliphs, the noble caliphs, the most just, God-fearing caliphs, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan ibn al-Hakam al-Amawi, that you will never get bored of reading his life story and biographies, and you will really be astonished how come this character could come out in the history of Islam. In fact, great numbers of scholars, they count him, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, as one of those people whom Allah sent to renew the religions of this ummah, so this ummah will come back to its true religions. The Prophet ﷺ said, Allah will send for this ummah at the end of every 100 years, a century, a man to renew for this ummah its deen. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah said that the majority of the scholars say that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, indeed, he gave the best example of his characters, of his justice, of his living in this life, taking so much of it, of his manners, that this man counted among those people whom Allah sent to renew the deen for this ummah, to bring them back on the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, known as one of the great caliphs, his mother Layla bint Asim, the daughter of Asim, the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhum. This means that his grandfathers from the side of his mother was Umar ibn al-Khattab. So no wonder that this great characters would come out from that noble and great family of Islam. He was a just ruler, a great imam, God-fearing persons, never fear any humans for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you would look at the secret of the greatness in these characters and this great shift in his life, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, he was one of the people who are part of so-called royal family, the caliphhoods of Islam, the Amawiyya caliphhoods, al-Khilafah al-Amawiyya. He used to live a very high class, luxurious life, used to own all kinds, if you could imagine, of palaces, dress with the best clothes and the best perfumes, and they used to ride the rides of the royal family. His life did not change because one of his close relatives died, or because he got old, or because he was taken by a tough sickness. No, the turning point in the character and the life of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is that when the caliphs at that time, Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, passed away, he entrusted and he selected Umar ibn Abdul Aziz to become the caliph for the Ummah at that time. That was the major turning point in the life of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. When he realized that he is now the caliph, he is the most powerful, if you would call, man in the state of Islam at that time. In his hand, the treasuries of the state, he could do anything he would want at that time. And this is the normal of mankind natures. When he gets more powerful, he starts exercising that power for the sake of his own selves and his own tribes and families. That was the turning point for Umar to become on the right path, because he realized that he has been given and entrusted with a very huge burden that he would be facing Allah on the day of resurrections. So he stayed away and run away from the luxurious life, from the high class life he used to live, and went into a very complete shift in his life to take very little of it for his own self and for his own family and children. The moment he has been given the caliphhood, he started the journey of justice. So the moment they buried Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, the previous caliph who died, now he become the caliphs of Islam, Khalifatul Muslimin, Amirul Mu'mineen. He was brought the rise of the royal family to come and ride over it, of this kind of transportation means. He refused to ride over them and he said, bring my own animals to take and ride, and they brought it for him. And instead of going to the place where every leader or king or caliph would go to his high class palaces and places, he went back to his own house and refused to live in the housings of the caliphhood at that time, because he did not want to be asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about all of these things that the caliphs used to have to live and have in that lives. He started a major reformation at his times. So he started by his own self. First, he looked of what he used to have and own of so many things. He sold it and gave the money to the house of the Muslims. Baytu Malul Muslimin, the house of the Muslims' money, where that money, that treasury is only for all the Muslims, not for a particular group or family. So he sold what he used to own and have at that times. And then he came to his own family and told his wife Fatima bint Abdul Malik. Fatima bint Abdul Malik, she is the daughter of a caliph, the wife of a caliph, and the sister of a caliph. Yani she is from the royal family, one of the rich women at that time. He gave her the choice. Fatima, is that either she gives up whatever she used to have and own and stay with him, or he would leave her? That pious woman, it is not an easy thing to do in this life, to give up all what they used to have and enjoy. She did that for the sake of Allah and choose to be with her husbands and give up all kind of jewelry, money, and so many things, and return it back to the house of the Muslims' money, Baytul Mal, the treasury of the Muslims, if I may translate it right. And then he started communicating with his own family, his cousins, all kind of princes among Bani Umayyah. He preached them, reminding them to bring back whatever they used to own, because that belongs to the treasury of the Muslim's house. And then he stopped everything they used to get on a monthly basis or whatever, among the gifts, etc. And he stopped and he cut off that completely from them. And he sent a clear message to them. All peoples, in my sultan, in my governorships, in my caliphate, are equal, are alike. And then he went on to his own government among the ministers, leaders, and other laborers. He terminated those whom he thought that they are not eligible, and chose among his people those people who are righteous, interested, and have great amana and great God-fearing and amana, and he appointed them on those positions. No wonder that this kind of actions would really bring him the anger of his relatives and those who used to live from the gifts and the money they took and the dedicated money that used to be given to them previously. So they send a messenger to him to remind him that they are angry, they are not satisfied, and they need to get what they used to have before. He said to the messengers, tell them that Umar says, and shortly he recited the following ayah in chapter Al-An'am, ayah 15. Qul inni akhafu in asaytu rabbi عذاب يوم عظيم. Say that I fear most if I disobey Allah, the torment, the punishment of a great day, the day of judgments. So this is the kind of leadership Umar exercised at his times. He advised his governors, ministers, justice, to be kind with peoples, and no one should stand on their doors as guards to prevent people from coming into them. One of his rulers, by the name of Al-Jarrah ibn Abdullah, wrote the hymns. He said, people of Khorasan, nearby the area of Iran, had really gone bad in their behaviors and their obedience to the rulers. And I think, the rulers said, and I think that nothing really will straighten them up except the sword and lashing them. When Umar saw that, and he said, Al-Jarrah said, then if Amir al-Mu'mini would allow me to do so, I would prefer that. So Umar radiallahu anhu said, and he wrote to him, Amma ba'd. And after he's saying, Assalamu alaikum, Amma ba'd, I have received your letters saying that the people of Khorasan had misbehaved and they behaved badly with you, and nothing was straightening them up except the sword and lashing them. You had lied, he's saying to his ruler. You lied, kadibta. The only thing was straightening people is justice and paying them right. So establish that among them. Wassalamu alaikum. Very short. He was very strict with his own rulers and governors and judges. His wife Fatima one day entered into his house while he was while he was praying. He was leaning on his hand, his tears coming on his faces, and she inquired him, what's wrong with you, Ya Umar? Ya Fatima, he said to her, I have been entrusted with a great matter of this ummah. Then I thought of all those people, the poor one who is hungry, the sick one who cannot find a medication for his own self, and the naked, and the orphan, and the widow, and the oppressed one, the strangers, the old man, and those who have a great numbers of children, and those who have only a little money, and many the like of that across my state, across the whole country. I knew, Ya Fatima, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to ask me about all of them on the Day of Judgment. And my opponent is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I feel that my argument would not be strong at that time. So I felt so pathetic and cried at that time. That is Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He ruled by justice, by straightening his own self and family, by lifting poverty and giving money to peoples to the limit, my brothers. That a man at his times used to have zakah. He wants to give it to the poor people across the country, across the Islamic state. He would travel from one place to another to find someone to accept his zakah. He could not find, because Umar ibn Abdul Aziz made them feel sufficient and content. So that man would give back his zakah to the house of the Muslims' treasury. He fed the poor peoples until no hungry man at that time would exist. He enabled the young, the youth, to get married. He bear the debts of people who are in debt. Even it was said that on his time, during his time, the Muslim used to throw and spread seeds over the mountains and the houses' roofs. You know why? Because to allow the birds to eat from that seeds. Because Umar, when he was asked, he said, so that it will not be said that those birds died out of hunger in the country of Muslims. So he really strove very hard to retain back anything that has been taken from people illegally. and gave people their rights. So justice and being strict with people and equality was really the major thing took place at the time and the tenure of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. No wonder then Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah said that Allah will give victory. I quoted this one before. Allah will give victory to the state that is just, even if that state is a non-Muslim state, and will not give victory to the state that is having established injustice and oppression, even if that state is a Muslim state. So justice was really a great thing that can only straighten the life of any nations on this land. وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وعلى من استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. عمر ابن عبد العزيز، he was so close to peoples. He orders the postman to deliver personally any letter would come to him. So one day he received a letter from where? From Egypt, from a poor black woman in Giza in Egypt. She wrote to him, I have a wall for my house which is short and broken. Thieves would jump over it and would they steal my chickens, and I have no money to fix it. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz wrote to his governor in Egypt, Ayyub ibn Shurahbil. He said to him, from the slave of Allah, Umar, Amir al-Mu'mineen, to Ayyub ibn Shurahbil, Salamullahi alayka, peace be with you. Amma ba'd, Fartuna, the name of that black woman, Fartuna wrote to me complaining that the wall of her house is short and her chicken would be stolen by thieves. So when you receive my letter, go by yourself and ride and go to her by yourself and fix her wall. And fix her walls. So that governor, he has no idea where this woman would be. Start searching for her in Al-Giza, in Egypt, until he was able to locate her, and he did exactly what Umar commanded him, the ruler of Egypt. Can you imagine that? Umar used to live this life with a very temperate, less living in these lives. It was said that he used to have only one clothes, one dress. If that dress will get dirty, they will wash it for him, and he will stay in his house until it will get dry, and then he will wear it. Part of his characters, part of the great attributes of these characters, he used to know by being silent a lot, and he is a deep thinking person. But when he would speak, he would really speak with eloquency, with great words, that when you read it, you realize that it came from the same prophetic lamb. His words are short, and no wonder it was easy to memorize. One of his sayings, for example, he used to say, people, straighten your own selves. Straighten your own inside. Your outside will be straightened for you. And work for your akhirah. Your dunya will be taken care for you. And he said, also, preserve the blessings and the ni'mah of Allah by thanking Allah, and preserve knowledge, ilm, by writings. And he said also, radiallahu anhu said, the foolish one is the one who will sell his akhirah for his dunya. Sorry, he said, the foolish one is not the one who will sell his akhirah for his dunya. The foolish one is the one who will sell his akhirah for the dunya of the others. Great statements, great words, and a great wisdoms out of it. And then, how was he died, radiallahu anhu? He died in his house while he was reciting the following verse in chapter Al-Qasas, ayah 83. تلك الدار الآخرة نجعلها للذين لا يريدون علوا في الأرض ولا فسادا والعاقبة للمتقين. That home of the hereafter, Jannah, we shall assign to those who rebel not against the truth with pride and oppressions in the land, nor do mischief by committing crimes, and the good end, والعاقبه, and the good end is for the righteous ones, the muttaqeen. He ended his life reciting this great ayah, indicating how great end his life was ended. He died in the month of Rajab, the 25th of Rajab, in the year of 101 of Hijriyah. Do you know how long was his tenure? How long was his caliphate? He did not need to establish a just state, a state based on justice, based on fairness, strictness, and God fearings. He did not need for a great number of years, my brothers. His caliphate lasted for 2 years, 5 months, and 4 days. He established that great justice state where people, there was no poor peoples. Everyone was equal, and we established justice among all the peoples. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz did not need all kinds of studies and consultants, all kinds of strategic plans, all kind of whatever the people today they are doing to establish a fair, a strict, and a strong and powerful and God-fearing states. So this is the great thing that we should learn. Umar was so God-fearing, vigilant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and took so much little of these lives. So if we want the doors of khair and barakah to be open for us in these lives, we shall really establish the command of Allah, the deen of Allah, into our own selves, our family, the society that we are living, observing the commands of Allah and staying from every haram in these lives. May Allah make us among those peoples. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammadin kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. وبارك اللهم على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا يا ربنا من الراشدين. اللهم وفقنا إلى كل ما تحب وترضى حتى نلقاك وأنت راض عنا يا رب العالمين. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب يا رب العالمين. اللهم أحسن خاتمتنا في هذه الدنيا وآمنا من عذاب القبر وفتنته يا رب العالمين. اللهم إنا نسألك الفردوس الأعلى من الجنة يا رب العالمين ومرافقة نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم عز الإسلام وانصر المسلمين وذل الشرك والكافرين ودمر أعداءك أعداء الدين يا قوي يا عزيز يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصر إخوان المجاهدين في كل مكان، اللهم انصرهم في سوريا وفي العراق وفي فلسطين والشيشان وفي اليمن وفي بورما وفي كل مكان يا رب العالمين. اللهم عليك بجميع أعداء المسلمين من اليهود والنصارى والرافضة والمنافقين يا رب العالمين. اللهم امكر بهم يا خير الماكرين وخذهم أخذ عزيز مقتدر يا قوي يا عزيز يا جبار السماوات والأرض يا رب العالمين. اللهم ارتق بإخواننا في الصومال، اللهم ارتق بهم وسد جوعهم واحفظهم وألف بين قلوبهم يا رب العالمين، وأبرم لهم من أمرهم رشدا يا رب العالمين. اللهم فرج هم المهمومين من المسلمين، ونفس كرب المكروبين، واقض الدين عن المدينين واشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين، وارحم اللهم موتانا وموتى المسلمين يا رب العالمين. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات يا رب العالمين. اللهم أمنا في أوطاننا وأصلح أئمتنا وولاة أمورنا واجعل ولايتنا في من خافك واتقاك واتبع رضاك يا رب العالمين. اللهم وفق لي أمر إلى كل ما تحب وترضى، وخذ بناصيتي للحق والتقوى يا رب العالمين، وانصر جنودنا على الحدود يا رب العالمين. اللهم ثبتهم واحفظهم وانصرهم يا قوي يا عزيز يا رب العالمين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، السلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.